cybersecurity frustration due to the number of the state of the government's vehicles going active. The cyber alarm campaign. The bottom of the surface provides the ship loads of these vehicles due to the return to ports in Kuwait. We're coming down from Kentucky. The water phase of the MRAP failed is a promise to ambush what's going on in Spanish. After one of the infections, we have 24 different variants of cases as to why we don't have a horse of which they can capture the number of people that have been in kind of this. Is that we have 24 different variants. That means in many instances, different brackets, different homes that have to be drawn through a different standard. Just a lot of things that have gone on, custom one by one, voice services, where we have something. Probably needs a dash production answer. I'm told by retired Colonel Rouge and my observation in North Dakota ship on the news is that government furnished very high tech, very classified equipment is installed on those destroyers, on those fighters at the manufacturer. I'm curious why a program that really needs to be moving is in pharmacy and I'm saying at the speed of light. Where we're taking, we're putting the vehicle in one place, shipping it to the other, and adding the government furnished equipment. And in some instances, I haven't gotten back to government mounted vehicle ever the night before Christmas or something like this stories. So we're looking at a vehicle and walking over to the vehicle and we need to get it, we need to get that back. So why don't you walk the committee through why are we doing this? Why are so many variants? And what can we do to run this line? Thanks.
Maybe I can start with the tech and then answer it. This is an idea to take in part the answer I offered before. We may or may not assure you made a predetermined effort to come to create common equipment installations for these vehicles. And there is a common term that we might cooperate to install the same term on these vehicles. They can create this both services, we'll have both voice tracker. Both services are using the same radio units. And for a period of time, we had agreement to install the same intervehicle or intercom system, radio system. But then the Army came back through, the Vice Chief of the Staff of the Army. It's an Army soldier who was trying on their particular system. It's in all their other vehicles. The common decision was to go on a radio system. The Army was very worried about having to do differential training for their soldiers in the field and their next to the floor, and they said, can we please go back? So, I'm pushing as hard as I can to get common to these installation issues before, and then you, about a day later, you have to respect the senior military leader's decision that says certain things have to be unique, and another piece of uniqueness is the jammers. The Marine Corps has a different operating concept in theater, and so it's currently using a different jammer than the Army. That is a significant difference because the difference is between those two jammers is substantial in size, weight, and power. That forces another different install. If we get to the new joint IED defeat organization, Crew 2 jammer, which will be common between Army and Marine Corps, we're going to be able to use that number. So all of these are those challenges we're confronting and we're dealing with them as fast as we can. To your specific question about installation, the jammers and other things. Great circumstances. I only want to go so far, but again, I'd be happy to talk to you more. But there are a lot of radio emissions from this vehicle. And so, Spanwar is, I think I'd say, uniquely qualified from a facility point of view to install this equipment, test it on a range, make sure there are no interferences, make sure the radio patterns that are produced by the vehicle are sufficient for all the purposes desired, and move forward. Every manufacturer doesn't have those kind of facilities. And so you would find yourself shipping vehicles from a manufacturer where they couldn't install and test it, it didn't work, shipping back, and other things. So I believe there are some significant efficiencies to massing the GFE as they want, having people who have installed GFE on one vehicle, install it in the next vehicle, and that vehicle is somewhat different. It doesn't involve differential training. But we are making to show you the next step. The team is making those choices every day. think I have to think of without pushing things back to vendors that can be done at the manufacturing side. I believe the general is only trying to do the things that spam on it if you already have to do it or they are almost efficiently done now because one person can install one of the jammers on the radios on the end of things. Honey, please give them the captain a chance to have one.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Seeing successes every day and improvements in the commonality of the different various different vehicles and the systems we're putting in. Our role obviously is a big area of electronic engineering and integration. That's what we specialize in our expertise in the testing, understanding, and applying complicated systems together in a small, confined area. The biggest challenge that we've had in the different configurations is doing the prototyping and moving through those processes for the different configurations. The big side where we're at today is we've completed a large number, especially the large volume of vehicles that we want to be seeing. And so now, the next in effect, every day we're seeing a marked improvement on the speed of that integration of any of those vehicles. We still have challenges in working through those with a very good community arrangement with the manufacturers. We have recently seen a large number of engineering changes, and we've put changes back for brackets and those sort of things and given penetrations to the manufacturers for us to do those in line with their processes so that we can improve the speed that we can do the electronic integration. We've also had working with a large group of industrial engineers to come in and look at our processes, see what else we can do, and that's a daily review, looking for opportunities to continue to improve. And so the continual process of improvement, the engineering changes back to the manufacturers, and then the learning curve, if you want to know, that would be the biggest part of the prototyping that we'll see every day. And then every day, our numbers of production, putting the electronic integration on to it. Captain, just a quick follow-up. Secretary, I'll touch on this. I very much appreciate the challenges of managing and operating with the different electronic components and folks who work with you very badly don't have the need for standard distances. But once you have made the determinations that this is where this antenna needs to go, this is where the antenna needs to go, why not send that work back to the factories? It's my understanding that in the fall of 1989, was a very significant one. It's also my understanding that sometimes in the past 100 years, they were going to back them. So, in the history of the city, they were very dramatic and earthquake there. And that when it comes to that, they're still worrying about that sort of thing. Does it really make sense that if there is one focal point where six or five or six manufacturers are receiving new equipment to be put together, and doesn't that become a vulnerability? One week doing since it began, I recognize it, but I don't know if you would. So, what are we doing to spread the work and to get this to get the right ideas to get it done right and get it done quickly? So, as far as the natural disaster from the Charleston area, we have another alternate facility about 60, 70 miles outside of Charleston in a different part of the state. Same square foot size, same type of industrial capability from the kind of integration type facility. So that's what we have in place that we're putting right now. Between now and Christmas, we will have in place an additional capacity for another 3 to 5 lines, actually above to what we have our current plan was at the 50 lines after the total talks about. And that will be additional capacity to add back to plan if there ever was a natural disaster. I think you send it to our plan to be able to relocate to that other continuing operations type facility.
Chairman, I believe that our previous press conference, Subcommittee 600 in Iraq by December 31st. The phone spent war, and then Jim again defined the point that spent war is very successful. They have plans and have applied in Six Sigma processes to it. They can process those vehicles, and you have to factor in the shipment times and some variability in the vessel. So I've been very hesitant to put a final number. I think it's significantly more than that 1,500, but it can happen. If maybe we could give you something for the record, I think we would be, I think, conservative and comfortable with until we get closer to December. Because the other thing is, I have to build 1,000 vehicles in November and 1,200 vehicles in December. That's the real goal. I can build 500. Optimistic about that, but I'm very dependent on my industry partners to be able to make the next jump from 500 to 1,000 and then to 1,200. That is critical before I can answer your question as to how many will be at the end.
It'll be somewhere between the 1,500 and the 3,600.
That's probably a good estimate.
Thank you very much. Acknowledging the significant work that has been done to produce MRAPs, how did dealing with the variation that you find when the trucks arrive in constant that are not ready for integration?
I mean, that's my captain over at the desk. Yes, sir. After that, there's been a very bad team arrangement between the CEO and the vendors. We have field service reps and the vendors right in Charleston working with us. In almost all cases, we're able to get the prototyping done. The integration done in a parallel process, working with the manufacturers to get the payments done right to do it in a short amount of time.
Are they not inspected before they're shipped, or what is the problem? They arrive not ready for integration.
They're certainly inspected. It's not a problem. It's basically that some of the vehicles were waiting, some components to some of the equipment, like air conditioning unit or whatever, and so dealing with the speed that we're trying to do in parallel with the processes, we call air conditioning acceptable vehicles, and the field service rep come to work alongside of our folks in our facilities so that we can work together to get an arrangement to complete the vehicles.
Is there anything that we can do to help?
Continued support on our efforts on what we're doing, I think, is a great thing.
Yeah, Mr. Taylor asked the next question. I was going to ask him, why can't you have the Seapower equipment installation done at the manufacturers and avoid this additional step? But I think that you answered that question. That's why we're trust.
So, Lawrenceburg, South Carolina is where I can get an operations facility that we've put in place. And it's similar as far as capacity of the building that we're using now. It's meant to be an emergency backup facility if there was a natural disaster, but also what we're doing in order to make that the run as smooth and efficient as possible if we ever need to qualify it. We are putting a limited number of lines over to that facility. The other benefit of that is it's additional capacity above what we currently have.
Mr. Chairman, I have an obvious question to ask. If we really want to get our maps as quickly as possible, and if we have this fallback facility that we could use in the event of a loss to primary land due to a natural disaster, why are we using both of them to produce more vehicles?
Yes, sir. In fact, that is the plan. Right now, the other important portion of the location of the facility that we're using now is the closeness to the testing, the electronic testing that we need to do. But we're only a couple of miles away. And not only from the prototyping, it's also part of the engineering change process that we need to do. For the electronic testing. As we get over the major problems in the completion of our road testing, we'll be able to more basically get out in our remote site than away from the testing facility.
Is it a manpower shortage that prohibits you from manufacturing both facilities now?
Yes, sir.
And is sure so we have a proper location. We can wrap up very quickly. We lost the primary. We want to get MRAPs in the field very quickly. And my obvious question is, why aren't we using both of them now?
That's all right. It's just the time that it's taken us to get the other facility up and running. And also where we're at in the prototyping process and the maturity of the process.
I'm still not going to clearly understand what gives us your data.
It's not good. Maybe I'll add a couple of quick comments to that. One, we are anxious about some of the issues that we're raising. I asked recently that the quality of work, given its experience in handling the number of bees and kidding them with grandkids, to look at what facilities they have and whether they can participate in our MRAP program, GFE equipment insertion. So they're taking a look at that. I'm waiting for an answer about that because I would see them as either about that facility or a potential augmentation of the growth of cancer. Spanwar's estimates right now say that at the single Charleston facility, they can process the full vehicle rate of 1,200 per month. I think we all have, this is one of the risk areas in a continued learning experience. We need industry to come over 1,200. We need to see Spanwar process 1,200. They're making very good progress in demonstrating the ability of process. It is 20 a day right now. So, it's not clear to us that we will be able to handle the workload, but we are looking at options for backup in the field of working in Spanwar facility and one of our army facilities.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Captain
Funk, I heard this comment last Friday, and I'm going to say it again today. When you talk about 50 different production lines, my observation was that they were indeed 50 lines. And it looked like there were like 50 different custom. One of the kind of events going on as opposed to one straight production line where at this station this is going, at the next station the antenna is in, at the next station the weapons are on. I have two in the account, but I very much respect your service to our nation. And I don't think we're going to get anywhere near the results that this nation needs with the situation that exists as laborers. And I was curious to what extent, if you got out to the private sector, folks are working to order 4G or folks who are in the business of hospitals, they're in the business of being a grandson. And I understand that we've asked you to do something on top of the normal. But towards that, you're trying to involve the industry and experts to expedite that process because I'm saying this not to belittle the efforts of anyone in your organization. I'm saying this because kids are being in the right to write to these vehicles and we need to get them. Tell me how you're going to get them.
Yes, so we have came with a large group of outside industrial experts with work assignments. And so standards as a chance for this community to work assignments. Judgment from one of our experts in the holistic signal process and understands industrial engineering and processes came with them of coming in and continually observing our processes. We also have the resident experts in the area of holistic signal process. Engineering. It's a daily effort to look at our processes, to look for that continual improvement. And then there's numerous examples on where we've had those improvements in the cooling areas and the measuring the turn beat at the right of the vehicles going through that, those efforts. Also working with the manufacturers, those engineering changes. I'm working with our teams, our team of engineers, already putting more of the brackets and the grilling and aligning those subframes back into the inline process of the building of the vehicles.
It's certain that when the industrial side of the manual factory is on, that get to full production, that you have the people. Equipment and the process in place to match that production so as to feel the best. So every time one rolls into Charleston, you're ready to take it within a day or two. It's going to
additional resources. You know, you've got to add additional people because there's the talent to create good habits. We have the people and the resources. We need to continue the teaming relationship. And we need to tight, close, working relationship effort with the manufacturers, obviously, for us all to be successful.
Keep informing us about what best looks like in their mission, and we'll work towards it. And then I have both these programs. We have provided knowledge, I think, in those two
two things to do. Takes us to our campuses to do if you want to start crap. And then we went backwards with Mr. Young. I just mentioned that the question of prototypes, which takes me to it. So some of the area that I've got a lot of going on great lengths today because I don't get to hear it and try to answer, but you wanted to make background. That's why I wasn't quite sure what you meant when you said that someone might, with regard to how the replacement demonstrated by tactical vehicle, that the prototype proposition might be seen by someone as looking at consistent goals. Could you remind me that I misunderstand what you were trying to do? I don't see it. I do not see any of the establishment of a prototype process that may be consistent with anything. Other than good fiscal, solid fiscal policy and solid legislative policy with regard to what we should fund and what we should do.
Mr. Chairman, I'm very grateful for your comments. I think what I was sensed in my comments is the department here worked on a strategy and said we would like to have a competition, pick someone based on a paper proposal to build a vehicle to replace the Humvee. Get vehicle cost half or less of what I'm giving cost and be more survivable, more answerable as an MRAP. I think electric technology supports that. Even if it does, I think consistent with your comments, I am, as the acting undersecretary said, it is a better strategy given the times we've gone into later stages of development with immature technology to do prototype work and convince ourselves that technology will support it. So across the department and the margin, we look very hard at identifying prototyping strategies, which raise your background here, they might be consistent with your view.
To be able to have Saturday, I can confirm it.
I was really bad at also, so I think
but I have an idea that anybody who is the public that listening to what you're saying might be a little bit shy, but maybe a little bit perturbed. That is what we're doing right now. The assumption I expect. Particularly in the private sector, would be a lot of money from the taxpayer, probably would be this definitely that you do things anyway, because the answer is no. So, what you're really talking about here is a change in culture, a change in approach. That is more than tinkering with the process. It's an entirely different concept of what constitutes the capacity to create technology, let alone utilize technology on behalf of the national security mission.
And in the end, what I particularly want to do is I want to learn less things and make mistakes, because we do have to learn, especially in technically risky things. I want to learn those lessons and make those mistakes when I'm spending lower monthly rates of taxpayer dollar expenditure in a prototyping phase, and hopefully not learn those lessons when I'm spending money at much higher rates in a very costly design and development phase.
Well, yeah, but you're also dealing with the context of the military industrial complex, and again, I don't use that in a pejorative sense. I use it in the sense of the line that was issued by President Eisenhower at the end of his term, and somebody who understood that even as much as he helped create the military industrial complex, he understood that there were consequences and implications of it. There's some reasons for that, right? And that's why
say it's not the journey of my life, but it's a tradition. Philosophical and analytical position to take. So, the reason I wanted to pursue a literary tool in this context, a little bit beyond that, we don't want to be in a situation where it's MRAP or anything else should be any kind of plan like this committee will have to, the subcommittees will have to deal with. As a part of our difficulty now that we hand out these contracts, have some to go on a piece of paper, and then say, okay, you go try and accomplish this. And what happens is we start spending not thousands or millions, but sometimes billions of dollars, and then create, and Mr. Karen made very clear, this is not a jobs program we're looking at here. Some jobs will come, some jobs might, they might be in some districts, they might not be in others. They might change. We had discussions with some of the people on our second panel, for example, saying, how are you prepared? Do you understand that you may gear up to a very high percentage of turnout, build up an overhead, both in terms of personnel and investment, which may have a termination point, which may have some kind of serious consequences for you financially. That's one of the reasons I'm so interested in the question of capital budgeting and so on. In this instance, then, what happens, this is my understanding of what you're driving at here, is that you've got an invested political interest in continuing what's going on. And it's hard for me. I have full understanding of any committee member's situation when somebody comes and says, look, Jonathan, look, Senator, we've got 1,000 jobs here. And this investment is gone. Of course, nothing's being accomplished. We're not really getting the helicopter. We're not really getting the plane. We're not really getting the tank. We're not really getting. We think we are. Maybe we will. We've got to slip it 4 years or 5 years. But you've got to keep giving us the money. And then what happens is that the capacity to what we're talking about right now, this rescue mission that Mr. Taylor is speaking of, is compromised. And it finds itself in extraordinary difficulty or requires us then to move very rapidly in another direction in terms of funding. Which more often than not will involve a supplemental budget because we didn't anticipate it during the regular budget process. It might be unfair to characterize it as. And if I'm not, am I correct in saying that you want to try and change that kind of that way of doing business? Okay. Does that then apply towards the MRAP too?
I think most aspects of MRAP are aligned with some of the things we're talking about.
Okay.
Multiple vendors to bring vehicles to test in the first phase of MRAP. And indeed, we leaned forward and bought vehicles from some of those vendors. And one or two of those vendors didn't pass the testing. And we have some of their vehicles, and that's the way it is. We're going to try to see if she's able to get right for training purposes so that the taxpayer money is not wasted. But they're not going to get more contracts.
So if members of Congress are serious about wanting to limit government the money to spend the dollar in the correct way and wanting to utilize it, we're going to have to rely on some part. There are some judgments being made, and that means some of us may have to say to our people, we don't get this, maybe we'll get something else, we'll have to move in another direction. As Mr. Taylor already indicated, that, you know, more than one of us has been through a situation where you told 1,300 people, whatever it is, this is not going to happen anymore. Right? So, okay, so approach with regard to the experience now with this singular focus on immigrants and the congressional push that's going on. The sense of applying lessons in terms of the survivability and testing on the field, that's what I'm trying to get at. And the following, like, if I understand it correctly, if we're following up on the field, asking for the soldiers in the field to give us information as to whether or not what we're giving them actually is accomplishing what they need. you're saying that in some instances, a lighter vehicle maybe not quite as glamorous is something that is seen as useful and applicable in other instances that they want to need something else.
Really good quality battle for the MRAP program per se. There's been a first round of development tests, the second round, which four of the vehicle vendors are still running the process of.
And I'm talking about testing in a theater center. I mean, I'm not saying I'm testing it in a theater center.
I might have been. If I could gradually work my way there, there's a third round of development testing. Those development tests are defined by what we're seeing in the theater in terms of the explosive price and everything. And then, the reality results in experience we bring in the theater, we get that data and process that both to define our tests and to learn what we need to do about vehicles going forward. So, yes, sir, that happens.
And Mr. Greenwell, you've escaped most of the detection today. Mr. Scott, there's no new involved. You know, Mr. Ellis knows it's strong. Well, it doesn't strong. You're as associated yourself with this approach.
Yes, sir. The start from this particular procurement on an industrial basis agile, that we've relied on commercial products and commercial vendors that we've been able to pull together in a very rapid period of time. So we can rapidly prototype with existing technologies and existing manufacturing. I think we're in it.
The country and the department will be well served if we see how that grant will move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair, Vice Chairman from Florida, and I recognize the gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Morrison.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank all of you for being here today. I'm so interested in that program. I'm interested as a member of Congress, I'm a veteran myself, but I'm particularly interested in that I have four sons serving in the military, one serving 4 years in Iraq, and others on his way to Iraq. So I'm interested for our troops. And, so much of the feelings I have are to provide the best equipment we can to protect our troops. What you're doing is so important, and I want to thank you for your efforts. In particular, I've had the opportunity, thanks to Council of Agriculture, to recently be in Iraq and Afghanistan. My national coordinator is in Afghanistan. I've, in my visits eight times to Iraq, four times to Afghanistan, this is like talking with persons in theater to find out how successful and how helpful the equipment that our young servicemen and women have. It's just like hard work, and so you're making such a difference. Also, Ken Gruber, I want to thank you. I've had that visit to Spangor. You have excellent personnel. They are so enthusiastic, and of course, I'm a bit partial. The chairman is the two daughters go to the College of Charleston. I have the extraordinary opportunity to be born in Charleston. So I'm very pleased about what y'all are doing. As we look ahead, I'm very interested to find out what is the planning for the long term sustainment for the MRAP program, and if you could answer that.
Unfortunately, none of us are exactly the right person to answer that question. The service chiefs have indicated, and the secretary Gates has asked them to think about that very issue. How will you long-term integrate MRAPs in force structure? And do you think those deliberations have not concluded yet? In general, the chiefs have indicated these are heavy and large vehicles, and for some of their operational concepts, very expeditionary, very mobile, they don't. Very well, obviously, for the circumstances we're around. So, some of the vehicles, service chiefs indicate, will be stored for a period of time. We might not need as many as we are buying from that situation if we're successful in continuing to stabilize around and enforce mission changes there. So, but those decisions are being deliberated on and agreed as we talk. And so, it gets us on doing it. Can't give you much more commentary than what I offer.
Mr. Abercrombie touched on this too, and that is, would you require another influx of funds in order to conclude a possible production grant in the MRAP program?
The funds that I understand Communications Conference for Cooperatives before I bring the Congress today, and you can give us what we need for fiscal year 2008, which is to maintain and possibly grow. In a matter of months, the Congress has provided $22 billion to buy these vehicles. It's far away from the biggest priority to me. In the space of time, in the department, so the Congress has been extremely helpful in this program.
I know I'm very supportive of what this can be to protect our troops. I thought of myself, I had early experience in the supply problems at the sub-tier supply events. There are, in April, but just recently, 2 months back, I cast the Defense Contract Management Agency to look for potential bottlenecks. They identified a number of them, but the most recent report is that these problems are manageable and that we're able to work our way through it. But there are potential choke points in the steel and the tires and the axles and a few subcomponents. But again, these problems have been worked on a daily basis. And because the MRAP program is a DX rating, which is essentially the MRAP. We're not seeing any supply disruptions that could occur. So I think we're doing a tremendous job still on by the vendors and by the public personnel. And we're coming out of
it. And I'll thank you as a veteran, thank you as a member of the military family. We want the best for our troops to protect our troops. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
We want to thank our witnesses. We also want to recognize our elected former representative of our witness today. Thanks for coming and keep us on our toes. Captain, last question. I'm curious, what was your thrill of your spare room? In September, my vehicles, what was it our mind to take a vehicle to get to your facility? To land the facility on the field in September. How long would it take that same vehicle to fly from the event to the facility today? And why should we anticipate the time for January? Because I'm going to get on it. I hope I'm not wrong. I hope you are exactly right. I hope there is no train back on the way. But I want to hear from you that you have a plan and you get that idea on you about these things that proceed through your facility quickly. So we don't pay them for the program. And so, right now, it's not our goal. Our goal is to get from time of receipt to embarkation to 7 days. It's a 7-day flowing process. It will not record the exact numbers we have for the month of September. For the end of the month of October, it was roughly 21 days. And the reason for that is the difference. September was less longer than that. And the reason for the difference and the reason why it's just much longer than we wanted to be or required to be is because in August, September, and up to October, we've been involved heavily in the prototyping process, which goes into the average flow rate, the calculation of those numbers. And so when we have a group of vehicles coming into the manufacturers, if we're going through the prototyping process, which takes us several more days than just doing the integration itself, basically we have to be able to say that there are way to get into the integration process when the prototyping is done. Now that we're over the majority of those hurdles, and we're over the majority of those prototyping processes, from a vehicle number rate over 80%, and now we're seeing it were growing, that we would be at this point, knowing that November was our big month, knowing that we needed to get through the most of the prototyping, so that when November, the longest line that we've seen to date, starts to flow, we can continue to narrow down that 21-day time. And it's not 21 days of integration, but that's from the time that it arrives and the time that it departs, basically, to get that down to that 7-day process. And so now we're seeing daily. An improvement on that speed. And I think that's successes are going to take work like that, working with the manufacturers. And now I'm working with respect to doing a process improvement to make sure we're making our weapons. When do you anticipate your facility will be at that 7-day target? So by the end of the month of November, we should have the capacity we estimate to our capability of that 40 vehicles a day. So that will be, that's more of the hard work tracking it and the whole entire process, because we're looking more at that, you know, keeping up with the flow of the drumbeat on the number of vehicles processing through. And then by mid-December, we're showing right now that we'll be at the full 50-day vehicles, which is what we require to get to be able to keep with the drumbeat on the flow of the vehicles. Keep pace. I've got to believe that the supply of these numbers of what is flowing through your facility to someone on almost an annual basis is incorrect. And so I would like to request that you also supply those numbers to this committee. Would you have a problem with that, or would Mr. Bell have a problem with that? Okay. And that way, we very much appreciate all of you. Yes, Mr. Bell.
I understand. Every time I meet the secretary, he shares the concern you have. I'm also busy spending more. You're facing the vehicles that you had to deal with the fact that the contractor from the vehicle types that show up. But this is the metric we all want. And it's why important that we're happy for us to have some backup plans too. It's a concern the secretary makes. I share your concern. I'm happy to share your data with you.
Captain, either you or someone in your organization last Friday that you said on the deliveries that come in your facility, that it starts out kind of slow, and then towards the end of the month, you take the data from where the vehicle's coming in, where someone makes an order on your organization to process the data straightforward time and manner. Work is being done, and I'm also going to give our vendors an opportunity. Let them know this is part of your question. What's being done to change that to get it more balanced out one quarter of the month's production in each week?
Yes, sir.
Coming from your vendors. Could you make it down to less than a million of your vehicles are easy to deliver to merge?
Is that right? I'm only going to speak from what we're seeing in our facility. It would not be like that one. We saw an improvement, although at the end of the month of October, we did have a big improvement at the end of the month, but not as bad as it was in the month of September. Already in the month of November, we see a marked improvement on a steady flow. There was a daily delivery of vehicles coming through. So the program office has done a great job changing that. And we're seeing, again, at our facility, we're already seeing a significant difference, especially this month right now, just the sort of month that we're starting, we're seeing an improvement there. Yes, sir, Secretary Young.
May I add to that? Because that is a challenge for Spadwell. It's a speed as I try to get that data. In the first 5 days of October, 21 vehicles were delivered. In the last 5 days of October, maybe 7 days, 231 vehicles were delivered. That was a very big wave at the back end. In the first 7 days of November so far, 111 vehicles have been delivered from industry. That's a very positive sign. Paul and Joe Burley and our team try to move the contracts to be weekly-based deliveries, maybe looking at daily-based deliveries. So we're going to try to force through the contracts that discipline and work with the vendors to get to that steadier flow.
Thank you, Secretary, for your additional questions. Mr. Secretary, we very much appreciate you and Ms. Bell being here. We appreciate your service to our nation. I want to give you one last opportunity. If there's anything you need for this committee to tell us now. This is the United States of America. We want to do our part. We expect you to do our part. If there's anything this Congress is not doing, we need to know about having
services and probably to execute it when we're being before. I think one of the things that would be an effective user strategy. First pass is most general down with Dr. Rayburn. For the community. Our second pattern, like, I'll start clicking in line. Now, of course, you can have a number of representatives of any state that are involved in the integration of our system in a first protective vehicle. They include this little bit of this. Systems. Mr. Gordon, the great Chief Executive Officer of Force Protection. Mr. David Heath, President of General Dynamics Land Systems. And Mr. Mercy Archie, Russell County, the President of the International Military and Government LLC. To 5 minutes. I'm glad to be flexible on that. I hope this is going to be provided if you're not going to test our codes today. So, in fairness to all of our witnesses, please try to call us expeditiously as you can, but we're willing to be flexible on the 5 minute rule. The chair of our wiki panel is Ms. Lee Dawson.
Thank you. Chairman Taylor, Chairman Abercrombie, Ranking Member Bartlett, I appreciate the opportunity to address your committee. Having submitted my statement for the record, I would like to provide a few opening comments. I appear before you today to discuss the MRAP systems produced by BAE Systems. Before beginning, on behalf of BAE Systems, I would like to thank the subcommittees and this Congress for your support of the MRAP program. I am the president of BAE Systems, Land and Armaments Operating. During my 35 years in the defense industry, I have never seen industry and government accomplish so much so fast. My organization has 18,000 employees across 17 states in the United States, as well as the United Kingdom, Sweden, and South Africa. All of my employees and the employees of Greater BAE Systems Corporation have made MRAP our number one priority. Our global business designs, produces, resets, upgrades, and provides worldwide support for combat vehicles, tactical vehicles, military armaments, naval fire support systems, advanced armor solutions, and individual soldier survivability systems for the United States and our allies. We bring all of these resources to the MRAP program. Having recently acquired armor holdings, we now provide the family of medium tactical vehicles, or FMTVs, and played a major role in improving Marine and soldier survivability by acquiring Humvees and providing advanced body armor on an accelerated schedule to meet the evolving threat. The combination of BAE Systems and armor holdings has resulted in unmatched capabilities and warfighter and vehicle survivability. But to date, we have received orders for 2,933 MRAP vehicles. Allow me to summarize our three MRAP systems currently under contract. First, the RG-31 vehicle has been produced since 1996 in our land system South Africa customers. Our legacy for building land-resistant vehicles in South Africa goes back 30 years. We have a business relationship with General Dynamics to allow them to market and co-produce the RG-31. I will defer to my colleague from GD to comment further on this contract. Second, building upon our RG-31 experience in South Africa, technology was transferred to our ground systems business here in the United States, and a next-generation line-resistant vehicle called the RG-33 was developed by BAE Systems. This design incorporates unprecedented survivability features tailored for our U.S. forces. The RG-33 is constructive production currently underway runs through April of 2008. And finally, as I mentioned previously, in July of 2007, the AE systems acquired on our release. That acquisition added an MRAP variant known as the Kilo, based upon the design of the U.S. Army's Family Medium Tactical Vehicles. In addition to meeting the MRAP survival and requirements, this vehicle has been designed to have parts commonality with the FMTV, resulting in enhanced supportability. The contract of production for Cayman runs out in February of 2008. Congress, the Office of the Secretary of Defense and the Services should be commended for recognizing this critical need to protect our troops and providing the necessary priority and funding. The AE systems has been leaning forward, both in self-funding activities in advance of contract, with the sole focus of rapidly delivering the most survivable vehicles to protect our troops. These efforts have been challenging, with requirements to deliver vehicles within weeks of contract award and only months after initial design. For example, we delivered Cayman's 43 days after contract award. We designed and delivered our G33 in less than 7 months, and subsequently the ambulance variant 13 weeks after contract award. We have 5 principal MRAP manufacturing sites: York, Pennsylvania; Aiken, South Carolina; Sealy, Texas; Fairfield, Ohio; and Johannesburg, South Africa. Assuming receipt of additional orders in time to ensure continuous production, we will achieve our currently planned maximum rate of 600 vehicles per month in April of next year. Moreover, activities underway to ensure the components of our MRAP variants can be built in all other major facilities. BA Systems is prepared to make additional capital investments to increase capacity. Lastly, we stand ready to further expand locally MRAP production by allowing other manufacturers to produce our new MRAP design variants under license if so desired. I would like to single out the MRAP program manager, Mr. Paul Mann, for his leadership and unceasing efforts to field MRAP. It is noteworthy that normal contractual practices could not possibly keep up with the fast pace of this program. We maintain an open, direct, and professional relationship with Mr. Mann and his program office. This collaboration within the framework of the contract deserves commendation. We are prepared to collaborate with the other prime contractors to improve survivability, accelerate production and fielding, and enhance sustainment of MRAP vehicles. We are already collaborating with the other prime contractors here to cross-train our field service representatives on all the vehicle variants to optimize and gather support. We stand ready to work with our colleagues here today to better meet the needs of the troops. In closing, and on behalf of the AE Systems and the Land and Armaments team, I would like to thank you for this invitation to come tell our MRAP story. We are very proud to be a part of the MRAP program, providing these highly survivable vehicles to the warfighters, and we are well positioned to respond rapidly to the continuing program needs. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I recognize Mr. Gordon McNulty, Chief Executive Officer of Force Protection.
Thank you, Chairman Taylor. Thank you, Chairman Abercrombie, members of the House Armed Services Committee. Force Protection Industries appreciates this opportunity to update with regard to the critical MRAP program. As of the 1st of November, Force Protection has delivered 1,389 kilowatt level of 9 protected vehicles to our service men and women. The area is 146 level of ramp clearance vehicles, 153 Cougar Iraqi light armored vehicles, 28 Cougar hardened engineered vehicles, 216 Cougar EOD rapid response vehicles, 5 Cougar engineered vehicles delivered in Canada, 108 Cougar Mastiffs for the United Kingdom, and 734 Cougar MRAP Category 1 and Category 2 vehicles. Let me put the delivery of those vehicles into some perspective. I'll provide a brief synopsis of our history relative to number 9 protected vehicles. Force Protection's sole mission is to manufacture, deliver, and maintain vehicles that feature the best protection available to the American and coalition service men and women facing the threat of improvised explosive devices. MRAP manufacturing is not an additional business line for us. It is is our only job. Every action we take, including investments and partnerships, is designed to help fulfill this mission. Forest Protection Industries was incorporated in early 2005. At that time, we employed 200 people and occupied 100,000 square feet of manufacturing space in South Carolina. By the end of 2005, we expanded to 250,000 square feet of space and 350 employees. Most importantly, we had delivered 60 vehicles. By the end of 2006, we had quintupled the number of vehicles delivered to 296. In 2006, we also expanded our manufacturing facilities to 450,000 square feet and added 400 employees for a total of 750 employees. Today, Forest Protection employs 1,800 workers and occupies nearly a million square feet of manufacturing space in four facilities in South Carolina and North Carolina. These manufacturing facilities are also supported by a significant research and development facility and a 300-acre blast and ballistics testing facility also located in South Carolina. In addition, we formed a new company, Forest Dynamics, through a joint venture with General Dynamics Land Systems. This partnership gives us access to General Dynamics' substantial manufacturing capabilities. And as a result, there are now multiple facilities manufacturing chambers. Our supply chain has been expanding, our ability to rapidly incorporate design improvements is greatly enhanced. But particularly now, we have been able to reduce the price of the Cougar by roughly $150,000 per vehicle to the current price of under $490,000. Finally, we expect the enterprise to include additional manufacturing ways of subcontracting and licensing agreements. Because of the potential demand for MRAP, we focused on two program goals. The first was to establish enough manufacturing capacity with our joint venture with General Dynamics so that we could deliver roughly 500 vehicles per month. The second goal was to license production to our commercial and military industrial contractors to expand or contract our delivery capacity as necessary to meet the demands of our local change program. Additionally, TN allows us to spread our manufacturing capability to ensure that we are not too reliant upon any one supplier or any one client. In fact, Mr. Chairman, this kind of teamwork has been a hallmark of Forest Protection's story. It has provided tremendous benefits for our men and women in harm's way. And now, as a summary today of Forest Protection's interaction with other manufacturers, through our joint venture with General Dynamics, Forest Protection has increased capacity across all functional areas, including engineering, manufacturing, supply chain management, logistics, planning, and execution, and sustainability. GDLS produced more than 60 proven vehicles in the month of October 2007 and will reach 194 vehicles per month by February 2008. Through Forest Protection's cooperation with Spartan Chassis, we've been able to expand our robust automotive and final assembly capability. As a consequence, our enterprise can now rely on Spartan to help us deliver several hundred Cougars per month. Working with Armor Holdings, formerly Storm Stevenson, and now BDD, Forest Protection today has delivered 200 additional Cougar vehicles. This capacity could be available for continuing delivery should sufficient work be required. Forest Protection, along with Marine Corps Logistics Base in Albany, Georgia, performs Cougar capsule manufacturing. This military depot is currently in production. Is a valuable part of our enterprise. By licensing our Cougar designs to BAE Ground Systems Division as the prime contractor, we have jointly delivered over 350 additional ground vehicles to the Iraqi Army. Forest Protection continues to produce and support these vehicles in conjunction with BAE. Ongoing discussions between Forest Protection and Red River Army Depot will facilitate the establishment of an Army MRAP's maintenance and training facility. We've also looked into Red River's manufacturing capacity in some fashion to manufacture Cougars, should the demand dictate. Likewise, Forest Protection has an existing agreement with Textron to manufacture Cougars. Although this agreement has not been executed due to a lack of orders, the opportunity is still available to us. Should the demands of the program warrant it, we will quickly add Textron to our team to accelerate deliveries and expand the manufacturing base for Cougar athletes. Finally, Mr. Chairman, Forest Protection is working with the Medical University of South Carolina, MUSC, to help fund the establishment of a research center to improve the medical technology available for diagnosing and treating traumatic brain injury, resulting from IED attacks. through this agreement, then you are soon to learn more about the physics of our blast. Using our South Carolina test rig, we hope to learn more about the physical effects on soldiers, thus enhancing the vehicle designs in an effort to prevent the injuries from occurring in the first place, and also to try to minimize them before they happen. In June of 2007, representatives of the Department of Navy asked Force Protection to determine the maximum production rates we could achieve by December 31st of 2008. An exhaustive review of every production aspect, including availability and training of new employees and access to critical parts for the crew, led us to conclude that the Force Protection light fleet could produce 500 vehicles per month by April of 2008 and 1,000 vehicles per month by July of 2008. That would be for a total of 12,100 MRAPs by the end of 2008. Our analysis defined four areas of concern: tapered roller bearings, which are used to manufacture our transfer cases, and axles. The inclusion of the DX-DS rating has eliminated the roller bearing concern, and we've identified alternative axle suppliers. Our analysis found no other showstoppers that would prevent us from being able to achieve production rates of approximately 1,000 vehicles per month, including steel, armored steel, engines, transmission, glass, tires, and wheels. Force Protection has enjoyed a highly professional relationship with all of our customer program officers. Throughout 3+ years of providing these vehicles, each and every one of the program officers has undertaken ways to facilitate our ability to deliver more efficiently. I'd like to publicly express my appreciation to Brigadier General Burton, Major General Cato, along with Mr. Barry Dillon, the Marine Corps Systems Committee, Mr. Paul Mann, program director, and his predecessor, Marine Colonel, Mr. Michael McGuchy, along with their staffs, Brigadier General John Buckley, and his staff at the Army Tech Command and Army Tech Automotive Armaments Command, and the Defense Contract Management Agency that worked so well with us to get these vehicles out the door in the quality they need to be. The kind of growth that we've been able to maintain is complete with challenges, which stem from establishing the requisite capacity, acquiring the necessary facilities, and deploying the native processes and procedures to manufacture in a reliable, repeatable fashion. Despite these challenges, each and every one of our customer agencies has demonstrated willingness to focus on the end result, delivery of these life-saving vehicles. Today, we have established open line of communication with the Marine Corps, Army, and DoD customers, and work closely with them in forecasting future demand to the maintenance of state duties now. Now, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to ask, what can the government do to help? The government can provide greater visibility into the long-term plans for the program. It's crucial for us to know what's coming down the pike. I think the same for all of us. But in the second half of this fiscal year, the government can facilitate the introduction of friendly foreign customers as a means to further stabilize the program and allow the industry to achieve maximum utility for the capacity we're creating. Likewise, the government can take advantage of long lead time material orders as a means of enabling us to secure critical supply deliveries in advance of production orders. It's been and remains our distinct pleasure and a privilege to be able to play a small but critical role in helping to ensure our servicemen and servicewomen can execute their missions and can love their loved ones. We are rightly proud of our efforts, of our people, and of our dedication to such an inspiring cause. Both program Buffalo vehicles perform extremely well in our active theaters of operation. As I have said, Force Protection's most important measure, the one we take home at the end of every day, is simple. It is the number of lives that our vehicles save. That's the mission that we live with. Thank you for the opportunity to provide this update on behalf of the bottom of the employees of Force Protection and all of our partners. We look forward to continuing part of this strategically important program. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Chairman Taylor, Chairman Abercrombie, Ranking Members Burton Saxton, for inviting us to testify today. My name is David Hewitt, President of General Dynamics Land Systems. It's an honor for me to represent General Dynamics Land Systems employees and our component suppliers who are building and ramp vehicles for American forces. My objective here today is to report to you that GDLS and our partners are focused on meeting or exceeding an extremely aggressive plan to deliver MRAP vehicles to our fighting forces. We've added manufacturing facilities, hired and trained employees, qualified suppliers who are helping suppliers increase their capacity. We've had additions coming to the startup programs, but we've done them and have continued to ramp up production. I know you're aware that I've submitted a written statement for record, so in the interest of brevity, but please let me simply address your specific questions in the next few minutes. I'm going to answer the last question on your own first. Specifically, are we willing to communicate and interact with the other MRAP suppliers to share best practices for MRAP vehicles? The answer, Mr. Chairman, is absolutely. There are minor contract terms that would need to be worked out, but we are ready to collaborate if doing so improves the survivability or production rates of these vehicles. We are already cooperating on specific ones, for example, at the Red River Arsenal, when service employees and ones of other manufacturers are being placed, trained, and performing maintenance on other MRAP vehicles that are being deployed. So are the military mechanics. That means that no matter which vehicle they might need to support, the maintenance personnel will have the training to keep MRAP vehicles in service. In response to your question about the relationship with the program office, communication and cooperation with the MRAP program office has been highly intense, professional, and effective. While we would have preferred earlier, larger contract awards, the program office provided early insights and potential awards to enable our planning. They rapidly issued contracts as soon as funds became available. Our product performance feedback from field testing and insights on emerging threats has been shared. GDLS complements the program office for its responsiveness to changing conditions and for their energetic and timely resolution of issues requiring immediate attention. You also asked about why our industrial capacity, material choke points at the sub-tier supplier level, and the expansion of GDLS Canada's industrial capacity. General Dynamics Lab Systems is producing two different types of vehicles for the MRAP program. The RG31 vehicle is under contract to General Dynamics Land Systems Canada. We have established a U.S. production site at Dama Corporation in Michigan, which will allow us to deliver 600 RG31 MRAP vehicles by March of 2008. This is an example of cooperation between the two major defense companies, General Dynamics and BAE, to provide urgently needed capability to our forces. The Cougar MRAP Category 1 and 2 vehicles are built in partnership with Force Protection Industries of South Carolina. With FPI's full support, in less than 120 days following contract award, GDLS capitalized, installed tooling, established process documentation, hired and trained hundreds of employees, and delivered its first complete MRAP vehicle from a new production site in Alabama. In addition, we established production at Spartan Motors in Michigan, which together with our Alabama site will produce 105 vehicles this month. And their combined monthly rate will be 226 by April of 2008. The Force Dynamics joint venture has combined the strengths and full capabilities of both companies to better manage, produce, and successfully deliver their MRAP vehicles. We have currently 55 Cougar MRAP vehicles ahead of schedule, and will continue to accelerate production. Together, the joint venture will deliver more than 2,700 vehicles by April of next year. Addressing your question about material choke points at the sub-tier supplier level, axles and high-hard steel supplies have been challenges for us at times, and we are developing alternative supply lines to overcome the issues. For vehicle axles, we are working with our contractor, American Axle and Manufacturing, Axletech, Nano Corporation, and Magna to augment our current suppliers. Similarly, we are bringing out a second source for high hard steel, Fundama, to complement the existing supplier network. We constantly take the pulse of our supply chain, monitoring to ensure what is replaced inside material in the end. In summary, permit me to assure you that we share your commitment to protecting our warfighters through the MRAP program. We are doing everything possible to meet or exceed planned deliveries, and we are willing to share best practices among MRAP suppliers. Maintaining high quality production momentum is
its own most critical objective, which means that funding from the orders must be in place if contracts are awarded by early December to avoid a disruption at the Alabama, Michigan, Ohio, and South Carolina production plants. Thank you for this opportunity and other fortunate persons. Chair Vice Chairman, the Chair of the Analysis. We have the opportunity to Mr. Archie, Vice Chairman, the Chair. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, distinguished members, ladies and gentlemen, I ask the military and government. Thank you. It's an honor to be here today for the community, and thank you for all you're doing and supporting this program and oversight. I mentioned this company, I've got 30 years experience with the company, and they've got to start in both the engine side as well as the truck manufacturing side. I sit steadily with the vice president of the defense group here, and it's quite an honor. People may recognize us as international partners for a decade or a day. And for over 100 years, we've been manufacturing vehicles. In fact, in 2006, we manufactured 160,000 commercial vehicles and 560,000 diesel engines. But then, in all our product, as well as supporting other customers. And you see our product all over the streets today. We look at our global presence. We have dealers in over 1,000 different states, as well as in North America and outside of the globe. And when you look at the dealers that we have in other countries, it's around over 75 different countries, including Iraq and Afghanistan. So we look at the spare parts support, the things that we bring a global presence with a commercial base. We've been not new to the defense business. We've been in the defense business since World War I. If you look at the trucks that were in World War I, World War II, and all the way through some of the other conflicts we've been in. But the MRAP experience that we've experienced on May 31 is when we first received our first contract. Since that day, May 31, 165 days later, we've delivered 407 vehicles. And 95 of those vehicles stay out there. There's more in the pipeline, obviously, with Europe and Spain world, as well as our manufacturing facility. We're on a path to achieve 500 per month by the end of February, and that's when we're on a contract to deliver. We have parts on the ground today within the military. We've delivered 58,000 part numbers to the Rayburn Army Depot to be deployed. In response to your questions regarding some of the adequate funding and some of the other concerns that we have, I think as my colleagues here were concerned beyond April, is whether or not there's going to be adequate funding to keep these lines hot and making sure that we don't have a disruption or a hiccup in the system that would cause us to idle the facility. When you look at the industrial base where we're at today, our issue is not building chassis, it's not getting product, and it's not manufacturing at West Point. Our issue today is bringing the supply base with us to achieve a 500 a month goal. And when I talk about the supply base, I'm primarily talking about product steel and manufacturing that product steel in our product. When you look at the cooperation that we see from the program office, I like my colleagues, John Brogan, Mr. Dillon, and Mr. Mann, it's been outstanding. It's been open door policy. We pick up the phone, we have an issue. The phone rings, they answer it. We get resolution fairly quickly. The DCMA and the Seapower integration process that we're working with, that you spoke about today, and we've had a very collaborative relationship with them, and we're on the ground with them today, doing integration in our facility today, and we have been since September. So we've been incorporating some of that spot work integration into the product and some of those things will start. Leading forward, I mean, that's one of the things that got us the depth that we have today, being able to aggressively go out and manufacture vehicles. We as a corporation took that risk, and we continue to take that risk. When we look at the collaboration against the Rubber Army Depot and doing a lot of the collaborative training, that's been a very wholesome environment, and I think working with Pentagon and some of the folks there to get that message across and get field training done across all our products and being able to train Rubber Army Depot folks along with putting FSRs in there. That's all been working very well. Mr. Chairman, we took this contract down back in May. We told our people this isn't a contract, it's a privilege. And we today in international look at that as truly a privilege. We welcome the opportunity to continue
continue. We look for the continued support with the armed services that we're working with today. And in closing, if Chairman asked me to provide a video of the way he thinks of his community, but we're able to provide that if you choose with unanimous consent, since we're all still members of the Subcommittee, and I have an opportunity to serve on this facility as I would like to. Give it to him an opportunity to serve and give it back to public support to have once involved in the ability to do that. So, if there are no objections, without objection, thank you.
Again, I want to thank all the witnesses for being with us. I hope they can make this going. Mr. Blake, one of the key, while I'm working on this, and we certainly want this to be shown. You know, mentioned some challenges with weird elements. I would ask that you could clarify that at this time, because again, part of this effort is to keep us up by stressing, but it's the American frustration. Anything that this kind of this can do to help you and your doctors, we would like to do now. So if you could, while we're waiting for the video, walk us through what those frustrations are and let us know what we can do to help with that. I'm sorry, the responsible people, so I'll tell you what my challenges are, and you can determine if you're the right people. The four of us that are sitting in panel today, we had a lunch before our candidates, and we had a telephone conversation prior to that lunch. And two things that we all agreed on. First of all, cooperation on this has been tremendous. The barriers we have are the visibility. I believe that many of the members have asked questions about visibility, how this program needs to be a program of record, this program, their needs and visibility. I think that this particular committee appears to have a great understanding of what's necessary in manufacturing. So the thing that we need most is visibility. We need to know what's going to happen with the program. We can't operate month to month. It's extremely difficult for us to make these investments. I believe each and every one of us at this table believe where we've purchased steel and components and very expensive items, yet in the belief that there is going to be a need for these vehicles. So the single most important thing to us is visibility going forward. If we can resolve that issue, we're all professional manufacturing people. That's the part that we need. Everything else is up to us. Everything else is up to us. We've resolved those issues up to this point by writing checks on our own small checkbooks at some times. Our particular company doesn't have a luxury of some of these companies. We've been around for 3 years. So when we write a check for tens of millions of dollars, it's a big deal. So that's it. Visibility. There's nothing else that would be more valuable to us than that, as I'm sure you know. I'm not sure if we're going to have the gentleman just say. I'm sure the gentleman knows that yesterday, on a very large group, the House of Congress, the Defense Appropriations Board, and I said approximately $435 billion. Yes, sir. Does that, in the provisions of that bill, so keep it too sick to keep your program going for the next fiscal year? Or if not, what is going to be? Sir, I'd have to see the provisions of the bill. I'm not familiar, but once I see the provisions of the bill, I can give you a better answer. I'm more than welcome. Yes, sir, we welcome your comments to the next board's end. Because that, or what gets there, will be a supplement at some point. Yes, sir, if we need to address it, we need to know specifically what you need. Yes, sir. We'll get back to you with that information as soon as I see the details. And we understand how the business is going to be on way. But you have a very accurate answer.
Can Selected to trade with a fixed universe of vehicles that you're going to buy, to spread them out over a large number of people, can do nothing but introduce variation and reduce the size of the opportunity that we get to invest in. So there's two things. It was have visibility of the program at large, but let the orders don't manage the program on a monthly basis with a series of small orders. I think you do that at the beginning so that you gain understanding who can perform and who can't. But once you get that understanding, it's to everyone's benefit to then issue long term larger orders so we can gear up. We've built these machines the lowest turbo line. Yeah, so that it was a two-part thing, basically the same thing.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. You have an extraordinarily interesting background. I think in terms of being someone who comes to say literally that you started out and where you are today as a result of a very extensive line of experience going back to Bandy and Rayburn. His active sisters is out there. This sort of statement, this sort of obviously being a future in the 1960s is not necessarily the same thing today. But some of the principles still apply, right? Yes, sir. Can you give me your perspective from where you sit today based on my point of your extraordinary experience as a tool maker? Subsequent to service in the Marine Corps, and through the various manifestations. You've been through just about every kind of manufacturing existing status. Is that a fair statement? I don't think I've seen anybody come up from the committee that has a more extensive experience than you with regard to the literally every aspect of the manufacturing leading to this MRAP manufacture today. So what you're doing today is almost the culmination of a lifetime experience. Is that a fair characterization?
Sure, when my family characterizes it, they call me unstable. But to answer your question seriously, yes, sir. Everything I've done today prepared me for what I have to do, which is take a company that virtually didn't exist 3 years ago. We had to build the company while building the product. And it wasn't one thing that had to be done. Everything had to be done. Any system that we needed had to be created before we could use it. And we had to introduce a product that did not exist before. And we came up with a production capability to support this enormous demand, this creates your evaluation of them. And that people, I would say, I think we know that we know what we're talking about. It's the iron resistant vehicle. It's a soft protected vehicle. What does that mean? There are people listening to us right now, taxpayers, interested citizens. What does it mean? What are you doing? And again, what is your evaluation of the vehicle that you are building? My evaluation of the vehicle that we're currently building is we have a part of all of the technology. The threat that we're seeing today in this war is not a threat that's new in the world. We've become aware of it in the Western world as a result of the most recent conflict. But all of the terrorist countries around the world have been experiencing these threats. So the threat's more than 40 years old. The vehicles that we build today are force protection. Our colleagues build our vehicles under license, and they're virtually the same vehicle. It's generally building around a ballistic capsule. We build a ballistic capsule to protect the people and the equipment that's inside of it. We consider everything to have the exterior to be expendable. And we also design it in such a way that it's reusable. The total cost for the reusable monocoque construction, which is what the kind of construction that used to build our ballistic capsule, the vehicle goes into harm's way and experiences a threat that takes place in such a short time frame. You cannot imagine the speed with which these events take place. And what happens? I'm going to describe it and I'm going to try to do as best I can without running afoul of any of the restrictions I placed on that relative to describing the performance of the vehicle. Either from the side or below the vehicle, there's an explosive force that can vary by tremendous amounts. The speeds with which this takes place, there can be energy traveling at
maybe up to 7,000 meters per second. Everything that's in the path of this energy is going to turn into a projectile. It can come from the side or it can come from above. There's an enormous blast of light bands. The force and the concentration of the force will take just about anything in its way. And it will be one of two things. It'll either rip apart or it'll come out at great speeds. The acceleration that takes place in these vehicles during all these events is almost unimaginable. That's why the people inside have to be buckled in. And they have to put them in that capsule that it's going to, regardless where it's turning. But it still has to be safe for the lands. And the body, the body's inside, and the body's not on it, subject to explosive trauma. Think, well, if it's more acceleration, if there's a penetration, it could be explosive trauma. Something penetrating the armor coming through, damaging the limb, just coming through, damaging the tissue. But by and large, if you can maintain the integrity of the home and keep the people strapped in, they may suffer some injuries, but they're likely to come home alive. So this is about as basic as it can be. If you turn it on again, is that correct? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I would use an analogy, but it's paired with the fuel-related drug analogy. The analogy between the feelings I had when I was in the military and the people that immediately followed me was living in a life of 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, on a tower, because no matter where you were, someone was trying to kill you. They might be your friend during the day, but at night they might be your enemy. They would kill you while you were sleeping, they would kill you while you were on liberty. And to have that kind of fear for such a continued period of time, and to wonder, is the government doing everything that they can do to protect me? And I think that awareness of that fear, when I walked into first protection for the first time, I wasn't looking for a job, I didn't need a job, and I didn't want a job. But when I walked in and saw how much this technology could address the fear that I know people feel when they're at war, and that somebody had to stay and get the government to buy these vehicles and build a manufacturing facility to build these vehicles, it was a moral imperative for me to not go home. I arrived at my company with one pair of trousers, two pair of underwear, and two shirts. That was 3 years ago. I haven't been home since. I came just to get some advice, and when I saw how effective this technology was, and I understood how much alleviation of fear we could begin with the point in one of our vehicles, I couldn't go home, and I still can't go home, but I won't be able to go home until the last person comes back from here, or until there's enough trucks over here that I feel that the people that need to go on patrol without fear will have the ability to go on patrol without fear. This is where we produce the engines that are related to the MRAP today. But this is also going back into our commercial base as well. And this is just the manufacturing facility that produces MRAP engines about 3 days before the chassis is manufactured in Garland, Texas. And you'll see that as it comes up in the next slide. It's very lean manufacturing, just in time. All engines are tested prior to being shipped. And when they get to the factory, they arrive at Garland Assembly Plant in Garland, Texas. The Garland, Texas is where the assembly line is that builds the chassis. This chassis plant alone
is about 60,000 vehicles a year. And this is where the first truck could be a garbage truck, it could be a snow picture. The third truck in the line could be an and you see that as the vehicles are. This plant has got plenty of capacity. We're running at about 4 days a week, 10-hour shifts. So we've got plenty of capacity. I will run the second shift more than on a Friday or Saturday overtime. This is where the vehicle gets the integration done with the arm. This is the West Point Mississippi facility. This was a co-engineer with the Mississippi State University. I got about this through the process integration in that factory. And this is literally an assembly line. This plant is facilitized for 500 a month. And we're right now running at the current rate next month of about, I think it's 250 vehicles, is what we're obligated to by contract. We've got roughly 500 employees in that facility today. When we get to the end of the 500 a month coming in February, we'll be roughly about 900 employees strong. Many of the employees I have by today have either relations or brothers or sisters serving in Iraq. And these people are very proud people to be able to provide this type of service. This is the other line that we've just established when we're doing the spyware integration. We're taking the work that we spoke to earlier and putting the spyware integration into the vehicle before it leaves our facility. Every truck is road tested. And DC enables through that. That's our first delivery in theater. And I guess that's the real test right there is when the soldier's getting it. And it's going to be on the set, bring it home safely. Thank you very much, Richard. Now it is to the gentleman from Maryland. Mr. Park.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I don't know how much more quickly we could have manufactured these vehicles that there's no limitation on the availability of subcontractors with the materials I need. But if you have no limitation on the materials that you need, as we're sitting here and discussing this, I look back through my 81 years of life, and I'm probably the only person in the room here that lived through World War II. I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, our country is not at war. The military is at war, our military families are at war, but our country is not at war. At this big World War II, we will stop turning out these Soviet SUVs and pickup trucks for personal transportation, and those assembly lines would have been producing these MRAP vehicles. I think that might have been good for the American people who don't get out of war. Our military is at war, our military families are at war, but the average person in this country, all we know about the wars, what they see on television, their life is not being impacted by. I think it would have been nice, Mr. Chairman, if we had a high hope for our enemy, maybe we could have impacted the lives of citizens of our country. I think they might have appreciated the sacrifices made by our service people and our service families. I want to thank you all very much for the contribution that you're making. You were kind of forced to do this at the premise. Thank you very much for your contribution. I hope that if we have another war, Mr. Chairman, our country will be more than a big war in our country since. We've fought a number of wars since then, but the country has not fought those wars. Thank you very much for your service to our country.
Thank you, Mr. Barlow, for some interesting remarks.
To commit Mr. Hitler and Mr. Basakai, I was hoping in terms of science, if you will, in terms of reach, corporate reach. Three of you, as opposed to my friend who spoke previously, are in much different corporate positions. And I just want to make sure, especially in the context that Mr. Barlow has just enunciated for us, if I understood particularly Mr. Masakata's remarks, do we have the assurance regardless of whether we move forward on a policy side, a program, or program, and legislative activity that ensures funding and rent. What about the question of the logistics of supply? I believe you mentioned the steel was mentioned, and of course, we have a particular kind of letter part on the classified side of things. That the steel is not necessary, the steel is not created equal, but is required of the components that may be resistant to soft protected vehicles. Different than the actual land that we're talking about. So, are we assured, are you assured, particularly say the internationals, are we assured that your cooperative agreements with one another are such that the supply side of things will be there, that the material side of things will be there, and if we are able to achieve the kind of visibility and continuity, if you will, in terms of policy, that we will be able to complete the task of providing these vehicles?
We have clearly secured adequate supply throughout our contract that we have today. When we get into the expanded capability of the next threat level, which is going to require more steel, there is a concern that we're tapping the industry, and we believe that there's going to have to be a global review of where else can we get higher up steel. I think when we look at the capacity constraints, I'm sure all of us here are using all of the same supply chain. That supply chain has only had so much capacity. And I think one of the concerns I have, and I'm sure my colleagues do as well, is that when you get into the next threat level, that it requires more steel, more capacity. What do you mean when you say the next threat level? It's going to require much more harder, broader base on the armor side. That's going to bring more resistant and logistical implications in terms of supply, possibly in terms of pricing. I think we're going to exceed capacity. That's why we're not going to steal some of the data.
Or an observation that you could share in that context.
I would like to make an observation. Chairman, I have a comment that relates back to the comment you made a bit earlier about whether our program of record was an important element of this program. As we looked at the program of record issue, what it really means is that you have the opportunity to gain insight into the program's future. That allows you to communicate with your supplier base, inform them of your needs, and to ensure that the capacity is there when you need it. The first point I would make on that is my compliments to Paul Mann and his team, because to the degree that they had information, they did share it with us early in the process. That allowed us to communicate with our supply base. That's what allowed us to go from an empty factory to production in less than 120 days. The second issue is that once you have that supply base condition for your program, having the timely receipt of funding is imperative to be able to keep that supply base going so that we have continuity of effort on one point. That's why my colleagues and made the comment that the earlier the larger the contract elements can be, the more we can condition that supply base to make the investments necessary to move forward more quickly.
You do, and in your biography, you bring some unique characteristics to the table. You have more than 3 decades of experience in the Army, much of which prepared you or caused you during your professional life in the service to be able to direct your attention to items like this, right? So, but when you speak about the program and record, you're not just speaking from the point of view of what's convenient for you now in your present capacity, but from your experience, I take it from your considering that we're in 3 decades of professional focus.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for mentioning that. I've spent more than 32 years on active duty with the United States Army. And in that period, I fell in love with soldiers. And my concern for soldiers continues today in what I do. But the point that I would make with you that's most relevant to the discussion of this committee today is that the employees of General Dynamics today, who I oversee, and those I'm sure and other panel members of play, share the same concern for the soldiers that are out there in arms rank level on time. So having worn a uniform does give me a special credential, and I'm proud of that. But working with employees who care as much about what they do and providing a service to the civilian community and our deployed forces is equally rewarding.
So the program around is not just a phrase about that we're talking about here today. It has real consequences on both sides of the equation, both in the private sector and in terms of the direction of the military service for which the term is being employed.
That's correct, Mr. Chairman. Just making sure that we see as clearly as possible as far into the future what the program needs allows us to harness the full capabilities of our companies and our employees to be there when we're needed.
Thank you. Besides, again, your testimony and paying particular attention to the discussion we're having right now, is that a fair summary?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it is. With regard to your questions about the supply chain, at the moment, we've been able to ramp up our supply chain. We're able to meet our commitments, and our supply chain is committed to the production schedules that we need to execute the contracts that we have today. And I echo Mr. Hinder's comments about the need to have some visibility. Chair Taylor talked about production planning and execution. When you're going to have the most effective production, where we can have the opportunity to maximize our production rate, we need insight into what's going to come so that we can place orders for material in a timely way, so that we don't ramp up to match production and then have to stop for a month and then pick it back up again to meet the coming orders and needs. So, to the extent any of you and our program management staff on the government side can assist us with information that will allow us to plan more effectively to keep these production lines that we work so hard to get in place and ramped up to maximum speed to keep them going for as long as the MRAP need requires. That would be very, very helpful in executing the balance of the requirements for this program.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman, I have the mayor of this program. Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to add what I meant by contributing at war. We have been at certain time in World War II saying, God, victory garden. And we have been, you were the patriot. Everybody died in the victory garden. There were no other things like 43, 44, and 45. Gasoline was rationed. Sugar was rationed. We saved our house and increased the ticket to a central repository. Everybody knew we were wrong enough. Everybody sacrificed because we went to the hand of phrase that the images of war, the museum of some images of war, more relevance to many of us than the images of a video game. I think that it's quite unfortunate that the amount of military damage is carrying such a heavy burden, and life continues just as it did before for most of the citizens of our country. I hope the next time I'm around, Mr. Chairman, I'll come to this, not just on military.
Thank you.
Next gentleman. Captain Hoover. Thank you for your service very much. You didn't get to be a captain by saying, I can't do it. I can't do it. You were saying, well, I could get things done and saying, you couldn't get things done. That's why it is. You said, if I had a rank, I'm going to make it having seen a facility. I'm not concerned. Organizations is at the full capacity. That they were right at the capacity to keep up with, and therefore that they was not getting any attention. I've been wrong. Of course, messages of your organization says, what could your organization do that is not being done in this government? In an effort to minimize the rest of the bill, speed up the action, make this as a new facility.
Thank you. processes. And as you suggested, there have been a number of engineering changes already in place because of that, which simply reflects the fact there is a process in place to do that. And the integration or interaction between the Spaceport people and the IR people is not inhibited in any way that I want.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to come back, Mr. Chairman, because after seeing the private sector come to place such an effort to protect our jobs, the facility is really grateful. Mr. Chairman, at the 25th anniversary of the BAA existence, it's adjacent to the district I represent, Beijing. Wonderful people dedicated working there. They've been forced protection of the electrons when they were born. And so I've had the privilege of even going ahead of the chairman to drive one of the coopers in Buffalo and say, well, it's hard to get ahead of Chairman Taylor, but I was. We appreciate so much the job dynamics and all of what you are doing to protect our troops and provide for protection. There's been discussion about the budget production contracts and working with state wars and how to avoid the end-of-the-month congestion. Is there a way to move toward revenue production? Contracts or even better. And then I could answer that would be good.
I'd be glad to answer that. I'm going to provide the statistics to show how much of an improvement there have been to get away from the hockey stock production. Last month, we half of our vehicles exactly what we should have done. We are in force protection. We're moving in the direction of doing weekly. And even daily production schedules. It's far with a higher risk when you do that, because on any given day, if anything goes wrong, it's going to be a really bad day, and there's going to be a lot of visibility relative to where we're around that day. That's not necessarily a bad thing. All of us in manufacturing understand that every day when you go in, it's a straight line. The number of variables that can work against you, any one of them can stop the entire system. So, we're willing to do it. That's the direction we're working in. But just the act of going to a monthly, a daily production schedule will solve the problems that are created. You've got to modify the processes that make it possible to do a daily production schedule. But that's exactly what we're doing. And that's what all of us are trying to do. There's nothing that would make us happier than every day when we go in, if everything happens on autopilot. It just isn't the case when you bring in new technology. As many variables as we have, as fast as we have to bring them together. So, any resistance to doing it is not finding any adequate resistance to do it. It's that we may not in every case have our entire supply base in a state that they can operate that way. And there are varying processes. You don't make steel by the day, you make steel by the heat. And so, somebody's going to deliver you 10,000 pounds of steel, and that's all going to be processed. And so it's kind of a catch 22. Some things come to you in big bulks, and you've got to manage them. And sometimes the bulks don't show up. But there certainly isn't any resistance to doing it from our side, but there certainly is a lot of difficulty in doing it. We're not a mature industry, and that's why it's difficult to set up the daily consistent process. If we were building islands or cameras, and we have 5 years to design the processes and get the supply chain in place. It's not that we're not aware that that's a better way to run a business. It's that the time in order to get the stability necessary to let your business operate that way has not been afforded to any of us. But we're not in the way for us to do it. And Mr. McDill, thank you. Itemize the different vehicles that have been provided American forces, Soviet forces, the Allied coalition forces, and the different types of vehicles. And I know it would be reassuring
serving overseas. Can you tell us how the performance of their vehicles have been?
There are certain restrictions placed on me about discussions of the performance of vehicles. I think everybody in this room can understand why. Our belief and understanding is that within our vehicles, when properly used, properly deployed, people properly dealt with it, the survivability rate is amazingly high. I can't get any more precision than that. It's amazingly high. We're very proud of our record of survivability, and we won't compromise in that measurement of interest in any way, shape, or form. The second thing I'll say relative to the performance of the vehicle, thus far we've been able to enjoy a 95% vehicle readiness rate. That's extremely important because these vehicles are only valuable when they're available. The design of our vehicles allows the vehicle to experience a blast, to sacrifice the external components, the truck comes and picks up the capsule, but we protect the engine, the transmission, the transfer case, and the important driveline items. We take it back to the motherboard, and then the field service reps from our company and those of our associates restore that vehicle and put the vehicle back again to service. Very few of our vehicles have been taken completely out of service. So the total cost of operating ballistic capsule type design is significantly less than any other style of vehicle because it's reusable.
I do thank all of you for what you're doing to protect the American and coalition forces. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
In fact, John, it's okay. I got the impression that this is something.
I was just going to comment on the weekly deliveries versus the monthly deliveries. And Mr. Hilton's comments were absolutely correct. Early on, we were not in a steady production flow. It was difficult to get material, and I believe that exacerbated the problem you mentioned. But I did want to state that on our Cayman MRAP system, we started performing to a weekly delivery schedule in September. We planned to go to a weekly delivery schedule in February on our RP-33 grading as well. So it's important to us to have a steady flow in the factory, as important as it is to our customers, and to stay more in terms of receiving vehicles. So that is the direction we're headed in.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, if I might add just a slightly different aspect in response to that question. And this is both for the committee's benefit and also for the employees who work in my vehicles around the country, frankly, around the world. And that is, we do not need additional motivation to build these vehicles as quickly as we possibly can. Our employees are committed to doing this as rapidly as it is possible. What happens on occasion is that we'll nearly complete a vehicle, and it will be a component that is deficient because the supply system hasn't gotten that quite on the schedule that we had anticipated. And that occasionally results in the delivery to spare of a significant number of vehicles at one time. Obviously, we try to minimize that, but our commitment and the commitment of our employees is to move just as quickly as we possibly can. And believe me, we are motivated to do that, and it would not take a different type of contract to cause us to do that. So, I very much appreciate that, but it leads to one of the following questions. Former Chairman Hunter, about his community concerns and looking at the delays and airport reactors. One of the things that he and the staffers that he dispatched to look into the problem discovery was that in many instances, the supplier did not know that what they were making was going to get something that was going to save the lives of non-Americans in Iraq and Afghanistan. And this quite frankly, the committee was very disappointed in that. Since that problem has only happened once, it was just going to happen again. Are you confident that each of your suppliers is aware of what that component is expected to do? Why is there a role in that? And why this would be the end of priority, and I hope you're awesome for that. I'm not president of the Secretary of Defense. He has the legal authority right now to work at the end of the fact that the United States of America is sending the troops in advance. I want you to put it to the top of the list. And I want you to know how to trust your authority. We want you to not surprise the fact that it's very bad to know that. I want this committee to be notified. If that's the message we have, we need to relate to the Secretary of Defense and the President to make sure that you get the things you need to make the product. This is a certain point to the troops. So I guess when I got the first person, do you feel like your suppliers know the importance of what they're doing? And how important the fact that you have to answer the troops?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I don't believe I could answer that question with certainty for all of our suppliers. What I can tell you is that in those areas where we felt challenged for the supply of specific components, the fact that these parts are a part of the MRAP program and the importance of velocity in developing and completing these vehicles has been communicated to other supply chains. And that we get a very positive and prompt response from any inquiries we have about the conditions of the supply base.
Mr. Chairman, if I may add as well, given that this program has been actually most important rating in the country, and we've had the opportunity to work with our suppliers on the implementation of the important priority through a contractual arrangement and also through informal arrangements. Part of that is a discussion of why we are doing what we do. At BAE, we have a saying, we protect us and protect us, and that the only thing that matters is doing the best thing for the troops in the field. We talk about that every day. Our employees embrace it, and our supply chain embraces it as well. But we do know why we're doing what we do, and it matters. We talk every day about what we do is saving lives and care and protecting family members and friends, and it's ingrained in each and every one of us. And to Mr. Bartlett's comments, the general public may not feel like we're I can assure you that we at BAE Systems do. We have people that haven't had a day off since the day MRAP started. We work around the clock 7 days a week, and there is absolutely no question that we understand the importance.
I also, we supply a lot of our product that we put in the vehicles, so as it goes across the various divisions within the corporation, we absolutely know the importance of this program. When you reach out beyond that to the supply base, our general counsel and the people that we work with in the supply community, we make sure that they understand what the parts they're supplying and the DX rating, as you stated, is absolutely out there in front of the curve of any production material that we use today. We have a solid supply chain behind us, and right now, just getting the production base up to speed at the levels that we talked about earlier to get to the higher levels of production is really all we have to do. To what extent the vehicles are being deployed, and hopefully we'll make it to market in less than 100 markets. What is your mechanism for staying in touch with the field so that as things run out, the entire response to its way, as things run out, that the factory becomes aware of it and it doesn't seem to be done right now? What do you have in place to make sure that happens? Yes, sir. Currently, we have force protection alone. We have approximately 200 field service reps in theater. We have access. We have almost $100 million in inventory in our warehouse and waiting to be shipped to the time it's requested. We cross train with all of our partners, everybody have access and enormous infrastructure of technical people to deal with restoration on the vehicles. We can't think of another thing that we can do to address the issue. It's those actions that allow us to keep our 95% readiness rate, and we're not happy with 95%. So we're going to continue to improve that as well as the relationship that we have with our partners that have this massive reach that allows us to accomplish that. And I'd also like to go back and address what Mr. Andrew said, your question, and one thing Mr. Andrew said. When we make sure that all of our suppliers understand how important it is, we had a supplier conference and we brought in 100% of our suppliers, and they didn't want their salesmen
someone who was in a significant position of management in Hispanic pay rules. It's going to what we were doing. We showed them many attempts. We explained to them about how they carried our philosophy for running the business, what part they played in it, and how they could make our entire system fail. No matter how big or small the part was that they manufactured, the entire system stops if they don't perform. We spent a great deal of time on that. I'd like to talk about Mr. Hittner's statement about motivation. At one point in the program, not too long ago, people were concerned that we weren't motivated enough with force protection. And in an effort to get us to work faster and harder, the United States government saw its way fit to offer a $1 million incentive payment if we would improve our performance. On the Fight Island, it caused significant chaos at the risk of challenging our relationship with Mr. Dillon. When we got the offer, we felt the incentive. And what we said was that we weren't interested in an incentive. If you needed us to do more, just tell us, and we'll do everything we can. We are already doing everything we can. The more that they asked us to do, we were able to accomplish. And they came back to us again and said, you're causing a problem because you won't agree to accept a contract that has an incentive built into it. After a lot of deliberation, I agreed that I would accept a contract with the offer of the $1 million acceleration incentive in it, as long as I didn't have to give the rest for the $1 million after I accelerated. So we accelerated, we improved the delivery, and we still, to this day, have not submitted the invoice to claim $1 million. We were going to do it anyway. The money didn't make any difference.
With regard to getting feedback from the field, we have an established infrastructure for the paddling fighting vehicle with field service reps in theater. We're also supplying field service reps for the MRAP program. In theater as well, and even though we have multiple variants of MRAP, we have one program manager in charge of all the BAE systems, field service reps working on MRAP. So we get daily feedback on what's happening in theater. So we know if we need to make any changes or fixes into our manufacturing processes or our design. We might also add that we've had two of our senior executives in MRAP in the last month to personally assess the situation and make sure there are no barriers that we could control in having an effective infrastructure set up in Iraq.
They are effective for what you're doing. Our drivers appreciate your work in this committee and the American people for the importance of this program. And I want to do so. I want to extend the invitation to anything that this committee can do to help you be more productive as. I want to extend the invitation. And lastly, I want to apologize on this book. I'm certainly sorry, wasn't the first specific person to die. I personally want to say that. And in the game, I have caused to use them.